This roundtable was not meant to stoke hysteria around Ebola. There's enough of that going on in the media. But it was a really hard look at how important this question is to get this right. Because, in fact, Ebola is going to be with us for a while. And, in fact, we've got a lot more potential pandemics on the horizon. So figuring out how to get new techs into the field fast and scale them up is going to be a problem and an issue we have to figure out pretty quickly.
We're in a period of very intensified urgent action across a spectrum of technologies, vaccines, therapies, diagnostics, medical products, PPEs, things like that. And it's coming against a backdrop of a fairly low and languishing period.
In periods like this, there's an abundance of attention, and there's even, I would say, quite a bit of funding. And one of the challenges is how to, in an effective way, put your money and effort in the highest value things and coordinate across those.
I mean, this is the classic problem of what we refer to as a low probability, high impact event. The problem is forward investing on these things tends to be difficult in many environments.
It's really not if there's going to be another pandemic, it's when. The root causes for these things happening, the rise of megacities, the movement of exotic vectors from one area to another, climate change.
I think a government-led private-public partnership around Ebola as a starting point, but really understanding, as Sam and others have said, that this is just a rehearsal opportunity.
There's many new technologies that could be used to combat Ebola in the field. We had some top tech folks here who actually have their own ideas and their own products. The issue here is how do we accelerate them through the process of government, get them to the field? And so we had a lot of issues emerge of what needed to happen.
When you have a problem like this, in some sense, the right answer for the federal government is yes. What it should do is do multiple things simultaneously, giving people contracts to actually build real things that are at a scale that matters.
I think that, you know, some of the other speakers mentioned some of the emergency authorizations that are available. Those are used a lot during crises like this where you need to move things very quickly. When this crisis happened, there were unending numbers of people that came out and approached us. Part of our challenge is sort of digging through all of that and understanding what's the best and highest potential.
I am deeply sympathetic to the fact that there are many technologies that potentially are relevant. And I would add, how do you deal with the enormous impedance mismatch between little companies, which tend to be the reservoirs of these technologies, and the government, which is so massive? We are at the moment literally talking to probably six different agencies of the US government simultaneously, having a staff of 25 people, and only one of them who has time to do this kind of thing. In order to have the technology, in order to deal with a crisis, you have to have developed it beforehand. And you have to do more than simply spread out some development dollars. You need to have some production dollars.
By all accounts, the U.S. government is really rising to the occasion here and leading the world in the response to Ebola. The public officials we had here on this roundtable were more than receptive to figuring out how can we improve the processes? How can we work better between private and public sectors?
We at the White House and OSTP, we are not the executors and implementers of the key strategies here, but to constantly be kind of stepping back and asking, you know, what are the next things that need to be developed? How are we going to scale those? Do the existing regulatory pathways work? We actually explicitly can have more open kind of conversation both across government and also with the private sector.
How the private sector and the public sector work together. I think time of crisis, we see a lot of innovation, we see a lot of things happening. You know, American exceptionalism tends to happen when the going gets tough in this country.
I think we need the world to help us prioritize. Yeah, we're smart in government, but if it's just up to us to say this is absolutely the most important and this isn't, and we have the funding and the regulatory mechanisms to do that, but how can we tap into a broader set of intelligence?
Claudia is absolutely right that we need the a constant discussion of priorities here. And then you need the ability to fund people who are actually doing things.
What was really great about this roundtable is that we really did talk about solutions, what could be done, some concrete ideas. And what was even more awesome is that we had concrete proposals of what we could do literally coming out of this roundtable.
What I would love to do is work with you and Sam and other people on the call that have domain expertise in here to build that consortium you mentioned. We're doing that now around open data and harmonizing data related to the Ebola response. I'd love to do that same thing on rapid diagnostics. First, getting an assessment of who are the players. Two is get those people in a room to understand what do we need to do to get to catalyze this moment, to do that in a consensus way, and then go out into the field and prove this out with real science. If we were able to build and end on a technology that would be deployable, how fast can we get the thing built at scale so we could actually take it into the field and run it?
One of the key challenges is how siloed our data are from a healthcare standpoint. Around the Ebola science, there hasn't been enough science and data in this area. What would it look like to have a new set of global norms for work that's funded where there would be a requirement that you contribute back to a commons and share what you're learning with scientists worldwide? Because I think some of the blockages are not sometimes they're government, sometimes they're the business models we have.
In addition to U.S. leadership, which has been pretty exceptional in this period, is that a number of non-traditional actors, most of them out of the West Coast Foundation side, have jumped into this in a very big way. The Gates Foundation putting $50 million on the table, but Paul Allen putting $126 million into the pot, Zuckerberg 25, Hewlett another 5. This amounted to a handful of agencies that are non-traditional actors putting over $200 million in quick dispersing money, much of it really focused upon technology.
Really like the idea of coalitions of the moment appearing and maybe having some kind of coordinating body to pull new money in and new players in who aren't really tied to existing programs.
As much as we were using this forum to think about the immediate response to Ebola, clearly what we were thinking here was long term. How do we build the infrastructure for what inevitably will be more frequent outbreaks like this in the future?
It feels like we're in Groundhog Day. We're seeing the same thing happen again and again. But what I'd love to see is us to step back and generalize a little bit and say, okay, what is it that we really need to do to prevent and look forward to that next pandemic that we're going to be dealing with?
In 1939, the President of the United States got together with the leaders of American industry and executed something called the Grand Strategy, and it was around America as the arsenal of democracy. I think if one could deal with some core strengthening of the public health system, because getting mobilized early is really important. We talk about West Africa, but we probably have forgotten about basic hygiene in the United States. But the other, I think, would really be creating a standing capacity and exercising it on an annual basis the same way the military does around a number of different areas.
So I just want to second Michael's comments. I think that the key thing here is to think about this in somewhat military terms. The military puts an enormous amount of emphasis on training and on training on scenario. And I think that fits with everything we've discussed here in terms of thinking about the next epidemic.